So our next speaker is Dolores Gallagher-Thompson. She's one of the founders of this Updates on Dementia, so a great pleasure to introduce her. She's an emeritus professor from Stanford's Department of Psychiatry and Behavioral Sciences, where she served as both a researcher and a clinician for many years. She started out at the Palo Alto VA, developing an interprofessional team training program and providing intensive training to psychology interns and postdocs in how to do CBT in older adults. She transferred full-time to Stanford in 1996 and did a semi-retirement, will you ever retire? I hope not, from there last August. Currently, she and colleagues Gwen Yeo and Linda Gerdner just completed the third edition of their book, Ethnicity and the Dementias, which you saw earlier, which will be published this October. Dolores is also very active as a volunteer with the Alzheimer's Association local chapter and is involved in international caregiver projects in Thailand, China, and India that are attempting to create viable programs for caregivers of persons with dementia in countries where few exist at present. Dolores?
Thank you. Thank you, Allison. It's a pleasure to be here and to have the opportunity to talk with you about a subject near and dear to my heart, which is various forms of psychotherapy and how they can help treat depression in the caregivers. We've heard that depression can be a risk factor for dementia, possibly. We've heard that depression is more common in caregivers than in non-caregivers. We've heard that caregivers who are depressed, that their care recipients don't live as long as caregivers who are not depressed. So I think there's a call to action here that we need to be able to provide evidence-based treatments to caregivers who are depressed. And so in this talk, I'm going to review briefly five of them that have some data behind them: cognitive behavior therapy, brief psychodynamic therapy, psychoeducational approaches, problem-solving therapy, and acceptance and commitment therapy. And I'll talk briefly about some other interventions that hold promise and also the technology, what I think about technology and how I think it can augment services to caregivers. So let's start with CBT, which is probably the one most familiar to those of you in the audience and the one that has the strongest evidence base. So CBT is problem-focused. It is oriented to the here and now. It encourages clients to learn about their depression, what seems to trigger it, and it particularly focuses clients on behavioral activation, learning to increase positive activities in their everyday lives, which tend to be very low in people with depression and even lower in very busy caregivers. And then also how to modify unhelpful thinking patterns, which is another hallmark of depression. People get in a rut and the negative thinking feeds upon itself so that after a while they can become very pessimistic about the future. For example, my life will never be the same since my spouse died. Well, to a certain degree, that is true on the face of it, but that's not a very adaptive way to proceed when one is undergoing bereavement. It can be a lot more helpful to think about how you've coped with loss before and how you will be able to adapt to life without that person. Clients practice these skills through homework or home practice, and we believe that the important thing that's happening here is that the sense of self-efficacy increases in the individual, that is the mediating variable. We also help clients prepare for depressogenic events in the future. Now, how do we do this with caregivers? Well, caregivers, we focus them on the negative thinking that is unique or specific to their caregiving situation. For example, someone says, why do I get so upset all the time? I'm not a very good caregiver. But we can help them reframe that into something like, I'm not upset all the time, and I did learn some deep breathing, and sometimes that works, and you know, makes me feel a little bit better, and then I can handle things. Caregivers also learn the positive activities, increasing those, but not just for themselves, but shared positive activities that they can do with the person with dementia, which improves the quality of life of both parties. So in an early study done with Ann Steffen and published in 1994, we offered 16 to 20 sessions of individual CBT using trained therapists and using these modifications that I just mentioned. Now, more recently, there have been a number of additional studies where the number of sessions has been varied, usually shorter, sometimes less than well-trained therapists have been used, but not necessarily those trained in CBT or certified in CBT, but those trained specifically for the project in an attempt to broaden the base so that CBT could be offered to more caregivers. And I'll talk about the results of that study in a minute. But the second form of therapy that I want to mention is brief psychodynamic therapy. And this focuses on the notion of separation and individuation as being kind of a core issue that needs to be worked on in the therapy. It is thought that caregivers' past conflicts over dependence and independence are reactivated by caregiving and expressed in the caregiver's difficulty separating their own emotions and needs from those of the person they're caring for. So the brief psychodynamic therapy often focuses on independence, developing that separation individuation continuum, and loss and grief. And a corrective emotional experience occurs through the reenactment of these conflicts within the therapeutic relationship. Now, in that study, where we were looking at the similarities and differences between CBT and psychodynamic therapy, we had a surprising finding, namely that the impact of both therapies was affected by the length of time that the individual had been a caregiver. So if you look at the left half of that slide, you'll see that for those who have been caregivers for fewer than 3.5 years, the psychodynamic therapy proved to show the greatest impact on all three measures, the Beck Depression Inventory, Hamilton Rating Scale for Depression, and the Geriatric Depression Scale. But in contrast, if you look at the right-hand side, caregivers who were in the role more than 3.5 years, CBT was uniformly more effective on the same three outcome measures. So this suggests that length of time as a caregiver or where people are in the trajectory of caregiving may be an important variable to consider when we want to determine what kind of treatment do we offer for depression. Why might this be the case? Why did we see this particular result? Well, it's possible, and our explanation for it was that longer-term caregivers may become depleted over time as they face greater demands and burdens, and their coping resources might get stretched very thin. So perhaps a structured approach like CBT that focuses on teaching coping skills is appropriate and generates some hope at that point in the process. In contrast, it's possible that caregivers benefit more from psychodynamic therapy in the early stages because they're dealing with loss and grief. When the diagnosis is made and it's confirmed, the caregiver starts looking at the loss, the real losses that are there at the current time and the anticipated future losses. And it may be that they need to work through this before the skill-building therapies can be most effective. Now, I want to speak about psychoeducational programs, which are generally derived from CBT. They teach the same skills, but in a different format, usually a small group or workshop format. And again, working on increasing the sense of self-efficacy or mastery. So I'm going to focus on the coping with caregiving program developed at the VA in Stanford by colleagues and myself about 20 years ago, and which has undergone a number of iterations since then. So it started as Coping with Caregiving, or CWC. It became Our Family Journey, and then it became the ACEs program, Active Caregiving Empowerment Skills, which is the one that we are using now. This slide shows some of the changes in the development of this program over time, in the number of sessions and in the content. So I'll briefly describe it. The Coping with Caregiving was used in its basic form a 12-session program in approximately one dozen randomized controlled trials. It's a very strong program at 12 sessions, and translational research was also done modifying it for Latino and Chinese American caregivers. However, its length proved to be cumbersome for some, and we learned that there is an insufficient focus on the positive aspects of caregiving based on feedback that we receive from caregivers in their evaluations. So that led to our family journey, which was systematically condensed from 12 sessions down to 4. You might say, how in the world did we do that? Well, it was not easy. It was pretty challenging. We tried to take what we thought were the key ingredients and focus on them, and we built in content on positive aspects of caregiving, very well received again, and also had the effect of reducing caregiver depression. The ACEs program now has some new content on resilience, which really encourages the caregiver to practice gratitude, forgiveness, and acts of kindness. This has been extremely well received. Journaling activities are included to reinforce what they're learning about this. We've done 4 pilot workshops so far, and we're now offering the program, the ACEs program, at the Stanford Neuroscience Center. It is free and open to the community upon meeting certain basic qualifications. And we think that this is the program that we would like to disseminate to those of you in the audience that might be interested. Please talk to me about it. It is available in Spanish, and we plan to offer the workshops bilingually in the area, East Palo Alto, Redwood City, and Menlo Park, later this year, because there is a strong Latino presence in those areas, and they have been typically underserved in prior years. Problem-solving therapy, you've heard about. Dr. Boudreaux talked about it. Many think of problem-solving therapy as a form of CBT, and it is in many ways because it does focus on tools for effective problem-solving, how can we do this in a better way. But it also places an importance on emotion, and in that sense, it's somewhat different from CBT, the early learning experiences and emotional regulation. So that those two elements, increased emotional regulation and learning efficient problem-solving techniques, are thought to build resilience to stress. And again, a number of studies show that to be the case. Now, how has problem-solving therapy been used with caregivers? Well, the early work was done with caregivers of persons with an MCI diagnosis or early-stage dementia. It focused on this specific skills that I mentioned and included behaviorally oriented action plans. And the early work done in 1996 was called the COPE program, emphasizing creativity, optimism, planning, and expert information in problem solving. It can be done in small group or individual formats with trained interventionists. It's been used now in several studies with caregivers who find it quite acceptable, and it significantly reduces their depression. So it's another form of evidence-based treatment that can be used effectively with dementia caregivers. Acceptance and commitment therapy is newer to the field. This is a form of therapy that focuses on learning to accept and tolerate uncomfortable emotions, not necessarily try to change them, but at least initially accept them. It encourages the person to learn techniques of mindfulness, that is part of the therapy program, so that they can stay in the moment, not judge the thoughts that are going through their mind, but let thoughts, negative feelings and thoughts be there and kind of pass through, and then choose a meaningful course of action. So it fosters acceptance as an active coping strategy in itself, since many problems in life cannot be changed or controlled. They need to be accepted for what they are before we can begin to deal with them. And this is a good fit for caregivers, in my opinion. There are a couple of studies that have been done in Spain, carried out by Andre Losada and his research group, applying ACT to caregivers. And they found that by helping the caregivers learn these mindfulness techniques to focus in the here and now, they're more centered and less emotionally driven. And that leads to the second piece of it, which is that they're more able to problem solve effectively and to distinguish between problems that can be solved or changed or modified versus those that cannot. So I think this is an advancement to the field and would like to see more of this research here in the United States. Some promising alternatives are group meditation and guided imagery programs. Several of those exist, and they are shown to reduce not only depression, but also anxiety and sleep disturbances in caregivers. A combined yoga and meditation program developed by colleagues at Palo Alto University in Palo Alto also found a reduction of depression and an increase in the person's reported ability to cope with stress. And finally, Tai Chi. A couple of studies show that Tai Chi has been effective. So now you see that there's a range of interventions, not just psychotherapy, but a broader range of interventions that may be useful. Other studies have found exercise to be helpful in reducing depression, both in persons with dementia and in their caregivers. However, the bulk of the body of research on these alternative treatments is relatively small, and so they haven't really reached the status yet of being considered evidence-based. Technology programs, well, I think technology has a lot of promise, not only as a delivery method, but also as a possible way of developing really innovative approaches that we haven't done so far. But so far, there are only a handful of psychologically oriented programs that have used technology. So one by Gabrielle Wills in Germany, which is not yet published, administered 12 sessions of traditional CBT over the telephone to depressed caregivers and reported very strong effects comparable to the face-to-face individual CBT, but less expensive and more able to be replicated. They feel that moderating factor here was resource motivational approach that they used to specifically increase the use of social supports and both internal and external. Sarah Saja and her group at the University of Miami used a video phone-based small group workshop to improve communication, similar to Skype, similar to having a group on Skype, but focusing on teaching communication skills, which follows up on what Dr. Levinson was saying, that this might be a way to implement some of those ideas, because I think the communication skill training could be very useful when the particular behavioral molecules that he was talking about are identified. Then perhaps they could be incorporated into such a program and delivered in that manner, which makes the program more accessible to people in different parts of the country, people who don't have the resources to get to a center, people who can't leave their loved one alone while they participate in psychotherapy. There are also web-based programs. I Care, I Support, Family Caregiver Alliance has some web-based programs, but most of the web-based programs that are in existence now are lengthy, and they're complex to navigate, so they're not widely adopted by caregivers. Once the research program is completed, there's very few new program users who adopt these programs. So in my opinion, we need more direct and appealing and simpler versions of these online programs. I think we should also make greater use of the smartphones and develop the applications that can that build upon the evidence-based treatments, but provide them in such a way that they're available to more people at a lower cost, because accessibility, I think, is an issue with getting psychotherapy, providing psychotherapy to people. So this goes back to the point I made at the beginning on the trajectory of caregiving. It seems obvious, perhaps, that different interventions are going to be appropriate for people at different points in the process. I think that's clear. However, there's very little research to back up that that statement. And the study that we did in 1994 is one of the few that actually focused on that that fact. You know, how do the needs change over time, and then how do we match our intervention, whether it be psychotherapy or some derivative of it or some technology-based program, how do we match the intervention to the needs of the person at that particular time? An unanswered question. A lot of work needs to be done on that. I also think we need to work on, we need to reevaluate, rethink this. I think caregiving is a family affair. I think everyone in this audience would agree with that. Yet virtually all of our interventions are targeted to an individual caregiver, a primary caregiver. We have no evidence-based interventions that work with the family. We have none. We have some very interesting and dynamic pilot studies, but haven't reached the level of an evidence base. I think we need to address that, because clearly one size does not fit all. So in conclusion, I'd like you to take away the notion that at the present time, CBT, in its many formats and in its derivatives, whether done individually or in a small group format, has the greatest evidence base behind it. And so if you want to provide the highest level of treatment to your clients, that would be should be number one on your list. There are other promising approaches, but we need more research on them, and we also need to look at this intersection of time or a point in the process and type of intervention. I think we also need to look at the cultural variables that might affect response to intervention. So we have a very diverse population in California. We have yet, however, very little research, only a handful of studies that really addresses the needs of caregivers of diverse backgrounds. So this is an important area for the future. We have some studies that have been done with Latino, Chinese, African American, and most recently Vietnamese caregivers. So we have some pilot work, and it's promising. It shows that many of these interventions that I've talked about and forms of psychotherapy, once they are adapted or culturally tailored to fit the population, that they work as well, if not better, in some cases, than on the Anglo group with which they were originally developed. But clearly, this is a huge challenge, and I think we've only scratched the surface. So we've come a long way in 20 plus years, but we have many unanswered questions, and we have a long way to go. So but I hope you will have some good takeaway messages from our talks today in terms of what you can offer to your clients now. What we know now, as well as what we need to learn. So thank you for your attention.